The book that I'm going to review today is a book by Cory Reese. It's a book which is called Nowhere Near First. The book actually could have been called It's Okay to Be Dead Last. Very ironic for a book that I'm saying inspired me to actually go the distance and do a 100-kilometer run. But I'll talk about that a bit later. But first about Cory. Cory is married. He's a father of three. He lives in the United States. He's a social worker. And that's what he was, just a normal bloke, normal person like us, until he got bitten by a running bug. And then he became a runner. He then became a marathoner, an ultramarathoner, and then became an author of two very popular books. So the book I'm reviewing today is actually his first book. It talks about his running experiences, his unlikely decision to actually take up running. It talks about how he got motivated. It talks about his experiences of his training. He talks about the successes, the failures. All of that gets covered in this book. Kind of just give you a crash course in ultra running. Here are some numbers on the screen, and I'll tell you what these numbers are. This is me in 2018. But if anybody can just guess as to what part of me is being talked about here when I'm saying 32,820, 2,500, 428, 4, and some sequence. Not a Fibonacci sequence, I know, but whatever it is. Any guesses? Yeah, that's the last line. But I'm talking about all these numbers, what these numbers are. Which one is the kilometer out of it? The last one. Yeah, that's an easy one. But anyway, this was the cumulative meters I climbed in covering 2,500 kilometers that I ran in 2018. I was there on the road for 428 hours running. I used four shoes, okay? And these were the ultra marathons I ran in 2018. I started off doing an 80 kilometer, ended with a whimper of just a 50 kilometer. In December, but those are the distances I ran in the six ultra marathon races. But these six ultra marathon races, which are just six numbers on the screen here, there's a very long story and a long preparation that we go through, that I went through during the year to actually get here. And these, the first four numbers are really talking about that. It's the number of, it's the kilometer that I ran. It's the meter that I climbed. Some of my ultra marathon races, for example, the race that I did in Hong Kong, the 100 kilometer race, actually had a cumulative elevation gain of about 3,800 meters. I did one in Malnad in October last year, which is the 110 kilometer race. It had a total cumulative elevation gain of about 5,000 odd meters. So in a way, I don't know how many times have I climbed Everest and come down, I don't know. I kind of lose track of that, right? But to know my neighbor who was doing a 21 kilometer, and I said, what is this half marathon distance? Let me go do a half marathon. And then by that time, by the way, I had enough of these specialized food products and nice Garmin watches and nice fancy shoes. And I said, if I don't use them for a full marathon, a 42 kilometer distance, I'm not really doing justice to these things. So let me go do a 42 kilometer. And after that, I heard of somebody who said, you know, I just went for this ultra marathon and there were only men out there. There weren't any women. Women are not capable of doing long distances. And I was like, really? Okay, let's test it out. And that's where I got bitten with the ultra. Ask me, why do I do it? And I'll just read out a sentence here because this describes it very beautifully. To run an ultra marathon, you have to be arrogant enough to believe that you can do it. And stupid enough to try it. Okay. That's why you actually go do ultra marathons, right? But how do you do it? You put your right foot, and then your left foot, then your right foot, and your left foot, and you repeat that for 6 to 72 hours. It's as simple as that. There isn't any magic about it, right? That's all that you have to do. And look at how happy I am. I mean, really, that's me. And by the way, that's in the middle of a 110 kilometer race that I did in October, I just talked about. And the picture on the left hand side is me climbing one of those hills. And the other one is getting down a hill. But I'm happy either ways, right? Well, this isn't the reality really, you know. The reality is this. If you can just reach the finish line in one piece, and that's all that we pray for. Let me tell you, in when you're running these kind of races, you suddenly become very religious. Yeah? You suddenly, honestly, you suddenly become very religious. You start praying for miracles to happen, for angels to appear, for somebody to come and just carry you somewhere. It doesn't happen. You have to use your two legs to get to the finish line eventually. Right? So, yeah, that's the reality. And, you know, I'll just kind of read out a few more things which we are told when we start running an ultra. These are the nuggets that I got when I started training first time for an ultra. If you start to feel good during an ultra, don't worry, you'll get over it. Okay? It hurts up to a point, and then it doesn't get any worse. It stops in the middle of the race. It looked as though someone had secretly replaced my toes with Vienna sausages. The aid station had nearly everything a runner could want. What it was solely lacking in was an oil can for rusty knees. And then he says, it felt as though my eyelashes were the only part of my body that wasn't hurting. And the blister that he had actually was big enough to need a birth certificate. So he kind of, you know, goes around and he gives us really humorous anecdotes from his own personal life and his own ultra running experiences. He talks about his various experiences of doing a 205 miler in 72 hours in his father's memory. He talks about his two failed attempts before he actually went and ran a marathon. He talks about running a 100 miler in a clown's costume and how it kind of itched and how it kind of made him very uncomfortable all through the race. But in the end, what he really kind of talks about is that why will you go do these kind of events? Is that you get those bragging rights. You know, you can sit back. Of course, you get bragging rights today. I can stand here and talk about it and say I did a 130-kilometer run. But really, you know, it's, if you sit back a few years later, you will be actually able to understand and probably, you know, kind of in a way understand the what you had done, the huge thing that you'd achieve when you actually were standing on the start line, and then when you reached in one single piece on the finish line. It he tells you how to do it. He says visualize the race, think about what can go wrong in the race, and that's exactly what I did. I kind of planned out my race strategy with some help from his book to be able to do a good job when I was out there. And he talks about, he says, be willing to embrace suffering. You know, pain is inevitable. You will pain. It will hurt. Sometimes in that phase, it will hurt and it will hurt more after that. But be, you know, embrace, because sometimes suffering can get you that strength. He talks about Newton's third law of motion, that for every action, there's a reaction. Every time you will hit deep down, you will have a reaction which will bring you back up. So he talks about those kind of things. And that's really what, you know, inspired me about this book and what I actually take away from that book. And, yeah, I mean, if I can do it, why can't you all as well? So come along.